Lord God, I want to thank you for this day, God. I want to ask a special blessing, Lord God, upon the persons who feel like they're all out of options, God. I want to ask you to just touch them, Lord God, even though they feel like they don't know which way to turn, God. They don't know what to do, God, Lord God, but I'm asking that you show up, Lord God, in their lives. Lord God, I'm asking that you let them know that you are still God, Lord God. Even though there's an eviction notice on the door, God, even though the tank may be on E, God, you are still God and your word is still true, God. I want to thank you, Lord God, for just being able to press through, Lord God, and let them know that you're still there, Lord God, and that you're still going to make a way, Lord God, even though the bills are still coming in the mail, Lord God, and we don't know where the money's going to come from, God. We're asking that you just touch those individuals, Lord God. We actually just touch that situation, Lord God. Touch that mother or that father or my brother and my sister, God, who may be struggling, Lord God, who may be considering things and considering options, God, that they probably dare not speak of, Lord God. But we know that you know, Lord God, and you know all about them, God. Lord God, I'm asking you that they be encouraged today, God, that they are motivated today, Lord God, that they feel like their hopes and their dreams are still possible, God, because we know that with you, everything is possible, Lord God, and I'm just thanking you in advance, Lord God, for them, Lord God. I'm thanking you for the blessings and the ways you're going to make, Lord God. I'm asking that you widen their territory, Lord God. Not let them think about the things that are behind them, Lord God, but let them be able to look to the things ahead of them, Lord God. Let them be able to press forward, Lord God. Lord God, you be there, Lord God, in the midst, Lord God, even though everything may seem chaotic, God, and they don't know what is going to happen next. They don't know what their next meal is going to be. They don't know where their next dollar is coming from, God. But you are able, Lord God. You are a healer, God. Lord God, you are a way maker, God. And I'm trusting, Lord God, and we're standing on your word today, God, that you're going to bless, Lord God. Even though, Lord God, they may be sleeping on the floor, Lord God, you are going to provide a shelter, Lord God. Lord God, even though there's tickets, there's problems, everything may just seem so hard, Lord God. Yes. But in you, Lord God, we can find peace and refuge, Lord God. Yes, God. Lord God, I'm asking that you
Hallelujah.
Break free, Lord God. Just dismantle strongholds, God. We're asking that you remove stumbling blocks, Lord God.
Hallelujah.
We're asking that you just remove all hurdles, all snares, God. We're asking, Lord God, that you be away, Lord God, that you make our path straight, Lord God. We're asking that you come and see about us, Lord God. Jesus said that if we cry out to you, God, you are going to come, Lord God. You are going to come see about your children, God. We're asking that you come and come see about us, Lord God. We're asking you, Lord God. Lord God, I am pleading on behalf of my brothers and sisters, Lord God, that you are the God that you were back then with Abraham, God. That you are the same God that you were back then with Joel, God. You are the same God that was with Moses, God. And I'm just thanking you, Lord God, for all your miracles then, and I'm thanking you for what you're doing now, God. You're still a miracle worker, God. You're still a healer, doctor. Lord God, you are still the great God, the undefeated God, the only God who has left death in the face, God. I just want to thank you, Lord God, for everything that you have done, Lord. You are able, Lord God.
3 days after arriving in the province, Festus went up from Caesarea to Jerusalem, where the chief priests and the Jewish leaders appeared before him and presented the charges against Paul. They requested Festus, as a favor to them, to have Paul transferred to Jerusalem, for they were preparing an ambush to kill him along the way. Festus answered,
"Paul is being held at Caesarea, and I myself am going there soon. Let some of your leaders come with me, and if the man has done anything wrong, they can press charges against him there."
After spending 8 or 10 days with them, Festus went down to Caesarea. The next day he convened the court and ordered that Paul be brought before him. When Paul came in, the Jews who had come down from Jerusalem stood around him. They brought many serious charges against him, but they could not prove them. Then Paul made his defense.
"I have done nothing wrong against the Jewish law, or against the temple, or against Caesar."
Festus, wishing to do the Jews a favor, said to Paul,
"Are you willing to go up to Jerusalem and stand trial before me there on these charges?"
Paul answered,
"I am now standing before Caesar's court, where I ought to be tried. I have not done any wrong to the Jews, as you yourself know very well. If, however, I am guilty of doing anything deserving death, I do not refuse to die. But if the charges brought against me by these Jews are not true, No one has the right to hand me over to them. I appeal to Caesar.
After Festus had conferred with his council, he declared,
Well, you have appealed to Caesar. To Caesar you will go.
A few days later, King Agrippa and Bernice arrived at Caesarea to pay their respects to Festus. Since they were spending many days there, Festus discussed Paul's case with the king. He said,
There is a man here whom Felix left as a prisoner. When I went to Jerusalem, the chief priests and the elders of the Jews brought charges against him and asked that he be condemned. I told them that it is not the Roman custom to hand over anyone before they have faced their accusers and have had an opportunity to defend themselves against the charges. When they came here with me, I did not delay the case, but convened the court the next day and ordered the man to be brought in. When his accusers got up to speak, they did not charge him with any of the crimes I had expected. Instead, they had some points of dispute with him about their own religion and about a dead man named Jesus who Paul claimed was alive. I was at a loss how to investigate such matters. So I asked if he would be willing to go to Jerusalem and stand trial there on these charges. But when Paul made his appeal to be held over for the emperor's decision, I ordered him held until I could send him to Caesar.
Then Agrippa said to Festus,
I would like to hear this man myself.
He replied,
Tomorrow you will hear him.
The next day, Agrippa and Bernice came with great pomp and entered the audience room with the high-ranking military officers and the prominent men of the city. At the command of Festus, Paul was brought in. Festus said,
King Agrippa, and all who are present with us, you see this man. The whole Jewish community has petitioned me about him in Jerusalem and here in Caesarea, shouting that he ought not to live any longer. I found he had done nothing deserving of death, but because he made his appeal to the emperor, I decided to send him to Rome. But I have nothing definite to write to his majesty about him. Therefore, I have brought him before all of you, and especially before you, King Agrippa, so that as a result of this investigation, I may have something to write. For I think it is unreasonable to send a prisoner on to Rome without specifying the charges against him.
Make some noise, hype it up. day. Today is the first day.
Today is the first
of the best days of your life.
Best days of your life.
Look out there, y'all. Tell us. Say it again. Say today.
Today is the first day of the best days of your life.
Guess what?
The best
is yet.
Is yet.
To come.
Says, what is the source? What is the source of the wars and fights among you? And then he goes and gives us the source. He says, the source are things that are at war inside of us. Very interesting that he doesn't say that the source is somebody else. He says, the source are things that war on the inside of us. The first key, and you can just write this somewhere on your handout. The first key to conflict resolution is that you make the first move. Okay? You make the first move. That's the first key. You make the first move. The second key is ask God for wisdom. That's the second key. Ask God for wisdom. And then the third key is start with your own faults. Start with your own faults. Don't start with addressing the issue in somebody else. Start with addressing your own faults. And then the fourth one, I must hear what's hurt or what hurts over what is said. I must hear what hurts over what is said. I must hear what hurts over what is said. And then we said that conflict is preceded by a what? Hurt. Conflict is preceded by a hurt. Every conflict is preceded by a hurt. And hurt comes from feeling what? Devalued. And there's an irony here. The irony is, just keep following along in your handout. It's right there. The irony is, how many of us have found that to be true? Okay? Hurt people, and are easily hurt by people. Now, here's what I want you to write down. Hurt comes from value issues. People are hurt. Typically, when people experience hurt inside of a relationship, it has something to do with not being valued in the relationship. This value thing is huge. It's huge. It's bigger than you think. One of the words that we use to talk about being devalued is the word disrespect. Disrespect is another word for feeling devalued. I don't know too many people who are willing to stand and work through conflict when they feel disrespected. Disrespect is a huge, huge issue. People are hurt over this issue of value. In fact, if you look at it scripturally on your handout, the first conflict, listen carefully, the first conflict in scripture was a conflict over value. Watch this. Genesis chapter 4, verses 1 through 7 says this. Now Adam had sexual relations with his wife, Eve, and she became pregnant. When she gave birth to Cain, she said, with the Lord's help, I have produced a man. Later, she gave birth to his brother and named him Abel. When they grew up, Abel became a shepherd while Cain cultivated the ground. Verse 3. When it was time for the harvest, Cain presented, now listen carefully. When it was time for the harvest, Cain presented some of his crops as a gift to the Lord. Verse 4. Abel also brought a gift, the best of the firstborn lambs from his flock. Watch this. The Lord accepted Abel and his gift, but he did not accept Cain and his gift. Did you get that? You missed it? Give it to you again. The Lord accepted Abel and his gift, but he did not accept Cain and his gift. This may, underline this next phrase, this made Cain what? Very angry. And he looked dejected. Why are you so angry? The Lord asked Cain. Why do you look so dejected? Watch what he says. You will be accepted if you do what is right. But if you refuse to do what is right, then watch out. Sin is crouching at the door, eager to control you, but you must subdue it and be its master. Did you get the value issue in the first conflict? Now, here's the rest of the story. The rest of the story is that Cain ended up getting with his brother and ended up killing him in the field over this issue. Yeah. Right? So he got with his brother, got together, out in the field, killed his brother over this issue. The question is, what's the issue? Notice what it says in verse 4. Abel also brought a gift, the best of the firstborn lambs from his flock. Now watch what it says. The Lord accepted Abel and his gift, but he did not accept Cain and his gift. Notice there are two things that are accepted or rejected. The gift and the person. God accepted Abel and his gift, but he did not accept Cain and his gift. So it wasn't that God just rejected the gift. It was that God rejected the person with the gift, or the person and the gift. And when Cain felt rejected, it's a values issue. And because of it, he became extremely angry to the point where he was even willing to kill his brother. Verse 7 says this, and it's interesting because what God doesn't do is he doesn't make a mention of the gift in verse 7. He says this, will you not be accepted, or you will be accepted if you do what is right? Right? So what the emphasis or the focus of the entire passage is really on the value within Cain as opposed to the gift that he brought. Does that make sense? And so this value issue is really, 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 really big. People kill over value issues. People kill over disrespect. One of the big issues in the street, whenever time, you know, you hear somebody get shot up in the street, 9 times out of 10, well, what'd he do? Man, boy, he disrespect me. And so we just shot him. Because he disrespected? Yes. Because this value issue is a huge issue for many, many of us. And so we learned that conflicts have two causes. The first cause is, on your handout, self-centeredness. And then the next cause, pride. Self-centeredness and pride.